Good morning, everyone, and thank you for joining us today for Kentucky Spin's Tuesday Tips webinar. We are going to be tackling executive functioning again across the lifespan. This is really part two of a series or of a session that we did a couple of months ago, and we have Sarah Bays back with us today, who is the field training coordinator for the Kentucky Autism Training Center. And she is going to be continuing the conversation that we had on executive functioning that was so wonderful. I am Stella Beard with Kentucky Spin. I also have Michaela Evans and Kelly Smith with us on the line. They will be helping facilitate questions today. And we're so happy that you have joined us. Before I turn it over to Sarah, I want to give you all just a little information about Kentucky Spin. We are the Special Parent Involvement Network. Which that's where we get our name with Kentucky Spin, and we are the Parent Training and Information Center, or the PTI, for the state of Kentucky. We're funded through the U.S. Department of Education, and we are actually mandated under the Individuals with Disabilities Education Act, and we have been the Parent Training and Information Center for Kentucky since 1988, and we recently just got funded again for another 5 years. So we're all very excited that we get to continue to provide that training, information, and support for children and youth with all types of disabilities, birth through age 26, and we work with parents, families, and professionals. And so we're very excited that we get to continue that with all of our partners and continue to collaborate with other agencies throughout the state of Kentucky. What we do not do is we do not act as attorneys. But however, we empower families to effectively advocate for their children, and we provide that peer support to help families access needed information and resources. And one of the things that drew me to Kentucky Spin years ago is that all of our staff are either parents who have a child or a young adult with an intellectual developmental disability, or we are a sibling, or we have a disability ourselves. So I love that, and that helps us be able to provide that peer support to help families navigate the special education process, but also provide them with information and resources. I have a 24-year-old with an intellectual disability, so I have been through the process, been through the special education process, and one of the things that my son continues to struggle with, even at 24, is those executive functioning skills. So this webinar is, I always learn so many great tips, and even from the first one, I put a few of Sarah's tips to practice, and it's been really, really good. But this slide here, we share almost at every one of our webinars, and it says, together we can accomplish great things for our children, but none of us have all the answers. We are all working through this pandemic and adjusting as we go, and that is so true. Way back in March, we started with these webinars, right when the pandemic began, and we have continued with those almost every Tuesday and every Thursday with different topics and information so that families are still able to receive the support that they need through all of this that we've been dealing with. So I am happy today to welcome again Sarah Bays. As I said, she is the field training coordinator for the Kentucky Autism Training Center. And we're so happy to have her today, and I'm going to let her just kind of chat a minute as I give her the control so she can begin to show her screen and the PowerPoint. So, Sarah, can you hear me?
I can. Can you guys hear me? I'm actually in my office today to have some better internet connectivity, so hopefully the audio is okay. If you guys can, just take a minute and drop something either in the chat. Sorry, I cannot multitask. Let me know how the audio is, and
they can put it in the question box. Some of them don't receive the chat box for some reason, which we can't quite figure that out yet. But if they want to type something in the question box, you should be able to see that too. But we can monitor that. But yes, I hear you just fine on my end.
All right, and hopefully you guys should see my introductory slide. I apologize to all you Cats fans, but it is very red and black. We are based out of the University of Louisville, but we are a statewide center. We provide training and resources to anyone across Kentucky. So hopefully our screen share is good to go.
Yes, ma'am. I see it just fine.
Okay, great. And also, you know, I see we have a couple different people here on the webinar today. Hopefully some of you were here for part one of the executive functioning training. If not, welcome. If you were in the first one, thank you for coming back. That means a lot. Also, if you get a moment, definitely check out part one that is recorded and archived on the Kentucky Spin YouTube channel. You can also find it on our KATC YouTube channel. We are able to pull different trainings that we do with different agencies. So today, there might be a slight overlap of content, but I really wanted to make today breaking down executive functioning tips. I so love Kentucky Spin's Tuesday tips to make sure that you all are getting practical strategies that you can begin implementing right now after this webinar. I also plan to leave plenty of time at the end for questions. So if any questions come up during the training, please feel free to send those in as you think of them, or you can save them to the end. I definitely plan to leave some time for that. So when we think about executive functioning, I always think about the fact that it's like our brain's air traffic control. You know, not anytime recently, but I'm sure most of us have been on a plane. And, you know, one of the most exciting parts is looking out the window as you're about to leave and you see the people with their headphones and their little wands, whatever those things are called, and they're directing those airplanes. That's what executive functioning does to our brain. It helps us prioritize, filter out unnecessary distractions, control our impulses. It's responsible for the planning, the monitoring, and the execution of our goals. It's something that not just individuals with autism struggle with. You know, I am a neurotypical adult. I have anxiety. I struggle with executive functioning. And I realize over my life, I've just kind of considered myself a type A or anal retentive. I just love labels and love to-do lists. So some of us need a bit more help when it comes to executive functioning. And so I wanted to be able to talk about what are some strategies that would effectively help people at any age to help overcome some executive dysfunction. And again, just keeping in mind that it's not just for individuals with autism. It's not even just for individuals with disabilities. You all will get some fun stories from my personal life throughout today as well. So hopefully we have gone to the next slide. I'm just double checking our screen sharing with the GoToWebinar. So hopefully
I see your slide perfectly fine.
Awesome. Thank you, Stella. All right, we should be ready to roll. So I train primarily on, you know, evidence-based practices for autism spectrum disorder. I share a lot of stories, either things that have helped either myself or in my teaching career or the students that I've taught in years past. But as a neurotypical adult, I really wanted to make sure, and I try to do this in all of my trainings, but especially one like today's, I wanted to reach out to autistic self-advocates and get their perspective on their daily experiences with executive dysfunction. So I reached out to self-advocates all across Kentucky and got some really great responses. And a lot of their tips and strategies are things I'm going to be sharing with you today. And one of the questions I asked them was this one: in what areas of your life have you experienced executive dysfunction? Because we know it's not an all day, every day type of situation. You know, some do experience issues with executive functioning across all areas of their life. You know, some of the autistic adults that I heard from mainly needed some support with finances and just organization with either work tasks or school-related tasks, some bureaucratic obligations, or even just trying to juggle everything that we have to do as an adult, trying to juggle school responsibilities, work responsibilities, and just being an adult, trying to maintain some sort of social life, and even now adding a pandemic to navigate on top of all of that. And I also wanted to share this next slide here. And you guys will all have a copy of this handout. Hopefully you've seen that over in your control panel. There is a PDF of all of these slides, so don't feel like you have to write all of this down. You will have access to everything that I have for you today. And I'm going to pause for a moment.
And also, Sarah, real quick, I forgot to tell everyone that if they don't want to download the PDF right now under the handouts tab, how they can do that, though, is there's a little arrow they can click down on the right-hand side dashboard, and you will see the handout, which is the PowerPoint that Sarah is using today. But we will send a follow-up email along with a certificate of completion later this afternoon, and all of that, the PowerPoint is included in that, too.
Great. That's right. You guys are so wonderful at sending those follow-up emails afterwards. And if anything comes up today, if there's another resource that you all would benefit from, we will send that out as well. So I want to pause for a few moments and let you all read through. This was a response that I got that was just so well put. I couldn't crop it. I couldn't, you know, abbreviate it at all. I wanted these words to stay the way they were. So I'm going to pause and let you read through one of the self-advocate's responses to my questions. And so often, I feel like either as a neurotypical adult or with someone that you are supporting, either a loved one or a student or someone that you're caring for who may have issues with executive functioning, often we don't really see the deficits or the issues until it's really hit that breaking point. Sometimes in ourselves, you know, we don't realize how much stress we've been under until we have that moment where we've truly hit that wall. So hopefully today we will have that common theme of having small tools along the way to help prevent this breakdown from happening in the end. Just as a quick review, and again, feel free to check out that first executive functioning training on either Kentucky SPIN or Kentucky Autism Training Center's YouTube. These next two slides will have some general categories of executive functioning skills, and I could talk for hours on end just about executive functioning and what those skills truly mean, but I definitely wanted to highlight some of these skills and just some general strategies. Some of them in particular, we're going to hit a lot of these, but definitely looking at if you or your loved one is really struggling in one of these areas, try to narrow down and see what are some things that we may be able to implement. So here we talk about metacognition, just really thinking about your own thinking, initiating tasks, maintaining that attention once you've started a task, working towards a goal, and then holding on to that memory with short-term and long-term memory. A few other areas here, and again, don't feel overwhelmed because we will hit a lot of these strategies as we talk about early childhood, school age, and adulthood strategies. Learning how to be flexible. I think Stella and I were talking before the webinar started, and just 2020 has been the year of flexibility. We have learned that life cannot go on as it has before, so we have to stop and realize that things happen. As a teacher, I loved to make mistakes and normalize those errors for my students, making sure that they realize it's okay to get something wrong and to make a mistake, but how to work through that. Planning and prioritizing tasks. And a big part of all of these is that self-advocacy, knowing how to ask for help or ask for feedback when you're not sure of something. Managing time, organizing your daily life or items in your life. Response inhibition. Sometimes we need to teach some replacement behaviors that are a bit more socially acceptable. And navigating our own emotional control and trying to balance all of these fun new emotions that we experience on a daily basis. And with all of this, we must prioritize. With any instruction or any interventions, we have to prioritize and truly try just one strategy at a time. Then we have to give it some time to truly see if it's working or not before we try something new. At the end of today, you're going to get a lot of resources to explore and some questionnaires that will be there towards the end to really help go through and check some boxes and see which maybe two areas should we start with and prioritize. And also knowing that everything that we talk about today is supposed to make life easier and better. We don't just want to add extra tasks or extra stress to make life even more difficult. So unless some questions have come through already, I may go ahead and just keep going and start with our first age group, which will be early childhood. And then, like I said, you can either save your questions or go ahead and type them in and we can address them all towards the end with a Q&A. Stella, are you seeing any that have come through so far?
No, I think you're good to go on and continue right now.
Great. All right, so with early childhood, you know, this is an area that can be challenging. You know, I personally don't have children. I have four-legged children for a reason. Young children just need so much support, and it's something that can be a lot of pressure, you know, to get it right. And we have a lot of preschools and Head Starts reaching out to us and just really wanting to do well for their students. And I also want to go ahead and note that throughout these three categories, the strategies that I talk about, they won't necessarily be specific to just that age range. So something that I talk about here in early childhood, we can definitely use with an adult. I just wanted to make sure to try it and divide them up between the categories that they would most be appropriate, at least to begin with. So our first strategy we're going to talk about, and if you've been to any training from me or from anyone at KATC, you have probably seen something similar to this. First thin boards are one of the best strategies to use, especially with early childhood. They are a way to really help young children understand that we can't always just do preferred things. Sometimes we have to do something undesired before we can do something that we really want to do. Also think, we do this ourselves as adults. Does anyone else, you know, after you've had a really rough workout or if you exercise, you know, 4 days a week, you may treat yourself on the weekend and get some ice cream or something. Or if you've had a really rough day, you really nailed something at work and you're like, you know what, I'm going to treat myself. We do this. Also, if you're like me, you'll go down and you'll start a load of laundry before you sit down on the couch and watch a TV show. We realize that we have to do some not so fun things before we get to do the fun things. And this is a great, easy strategy for young children to start identifying and building that routine. So the biggest thing to think about with first thin boards, and we have a few short videos on our YouTube going much more in depth about these, but in the beginning, you want to start with two very preferred things that your child likes. So they're going to think they hit the lottery. They are going to say, wow, I get to, you know, play with Legos and then I get to get on the iPad. What's wrong with you? Like, this is crazy. They really need to buy into that system. And it has some sort of visual component. If you don't have a printer or a laminator or something like that, simple small boxes. You can get those clear shoe boxes at the Dollar Tree for a dollar, or just even a piece of paper with a line drawn in half and the words first and then. You know, put a toothbrush in one box and then maybe put their bedtime story in another box, just so they can visually see, first I need to brush my teeth and then we get to read our bedtime story. And it's that nice visual reminder. And you're slowly gonna reduce that first activity to something that's a little less preferred each time to, again, build that momentum and help your child really buy into the system and understand what it means. And again, knowing this isn't bribery, it's just a basic principle of life. We all do this intentionally with ourselves, even if we don't know it. Another early childhood strategy, and it's one of my favorites, again, is that type A. As a teacher, people would joke that they would come to my classroom to find things because everything was labeled and they knew exactly where things were. Labels are going to be excellent, especially for early childhood, to start building that independence, as well as consistency and organization, knowing where their things are and where things get put back. So if there are certain snacks that they really enjoy, if those are in specific cabinets, putting a picture of those so that they know which cabinet to go to, or, you know, a young child probably wouldn't use a can opener, but labeling things in the kitchen, labeling the dressers, that image there, I was surprised at how many decals are sold on Amazon and Etsy for things like dresser drawers in a child's room. Even just free printables, post-it notes will be your best friend. And there is an excellent quote that I love, and it's out of the TEACH program at the UNC University. And they always say, everything has a place, and there's a place for everything. So knowing that if your child knows that if I need my paint by sticker cards, they're going to be in the second shelf, third drawer. They're always going to be there. I have this nice label if I need to remember. And it's also going to help you as a parent know where things are. And again, teaching that independence and responsibility to your children to start putting things away or getting things on their own. Labels can be a nice, easy introduction to that. Additionally, coming up with some visual instructions. Visual supports are going to be a great tool to use for any executive functioning challenges. These are going to, again, build that independence for your young children, building that routine, knowing that every time I go into the bathroom to wash my hands, these are the steps I'm going to follow every single time, and multiple opportunities to practice those skills correctly. And what visuals do is they allow the adult to kind of fade out of the situation. That picture on the left is one of my favorites to use in trainings. It was something that I was out in a preschool, and we had a young friend who was trying to go through toilet training. And if any of you have children, you know, all the power to you, because that is something that is a challenge. And this little guy, he was really needing a lot of adult verbal prompts to go through the steps that it takes to go in, use the restroom, you know, clean up, get dressed, and leave. And the teacher and I made this really quick little photo ring of visual supports for each step of that process. We really had to break it down, you know, to things like, you know, he needed to take his shoes on and off as part of that process. And they were in a preschool setting, so there were additional, safety and hygiene things to think about in that public restroom. And eventually, very quickly, he got to the point where the adult just needed to stand and flip those cards. He didn't need to be told 6 times to pull his pants back up. He was able to just look at that card, sometimes with a point or with a some sort of verbal prompt. But then that's something he could eventually just go through on his own and look at those steps that he needs to follow. Another early childhood tip is getting your kids at the earliest age into some sort of home responsibility, some sort of chore. Now, some of these looking through, I'm like, where's the one about mowing the lawn? I don't know if I'd trust a 12-year-old to mow my lawn. Maybe just I'm a little particular about the way I want it done. And even a 2 or 3-year-old wiping baseboards as a 33-year-old, I hate doing that. So I don't know if I'd make a 2 or 3-year-old do that. But looking through and finding some age-appropriate chores, what are some things that your child can do around the house? Again, building that sense of responsibility, making it part of their daily routine in their schedule, if there's a certain time for a certain chore, time management skills, you know, learning how long it takes to do certain things. Is taking out the trash a 30-minute task or a 2-minute task? Where does that fall in my daily schedule? And planning your daily activities around the things that you just must get done, that you have to get done. So even if it's just one chore, having something as part of your child's day that they need to do for the household as well. So I'm going to jump into the school age strategies. And again, I will emphasize this. Everything that I just talked about with early childhood is still appropriate for school age and adulthood. It just may look a little bit different and vice versa. Some of these school age strategies you could use with, you know, a preschooler or early childhood. So for school age, the most successful one that I know about has been visual timers. They can look many different ways. Even those old school sand timers that you used to have in board games that kids don't really know what those are these days. I was blown away when kids were just astonished by these sand timers. They'd never seen them before. Anyone who grew up in the 90s, we had those little gel timers that we put on our desk and we just thought they were fun. But they are excellent ways to show the passing of time. They've come in handy more times than I've thought. One, as a behavior management strategy, helping children, you know, de-escalate, but also helping to teach the concept of time. What an interval of time feels like. You know, if I were in a room full of people and I asked you to count out 1 minute and raise your hand when that minute was over, all of our hands would go up at different times. Our concept of time, even as neurotypical adults, is very skewed. But helping our children and the adults that we're supporting understand what certain lengths of time feel like and how much time may be left during a certain time frame or an activity. The time timer, which you see there, there are actual little clocks that we use, but also there is a free app. I know it's free on the Apple App Store, but there is a free timer that you can set different activities, you can set different colors. And what it does is that red piece slowly gets smaller and smaller as the time is elapsing. So it's that nice visual reminder that I'm almost finished with this. Even things like warnings before transitions. That's why I love the 5, 4, 3, 2, 1 countdowns that, again, don't need to be beautiful, printed and colorful and laminated. You can get out a sheet of paper or post it, write the numbers 5, 4, 3, 2, 1, and every minute or so, mark off one of those numbers or just walk by and take one of those numbers off to show that time is elapsing, that we're almost finished, we're almost to the end. Those warnings before transitions can be very helpful and reduce that abrupt ending or change or stress that can come with, but I wasn't finished, I didn't get to finish this. Another very surprising but very helpful strategy with that is a pause card. This has been something that, again, has saved my life in many, many opportunities. Kids these days, I'm only 33, but I'm already saying kids these days, so forgive me. But they know what that pause button means. They are watching videos either on their TVs or their iPads or YouTube. They know what play and pause are like and what those buttons are and represent. So a pause card can be very helpful to just put an activity on pause. Maybe if we need to rush out the door to get to a doctor's office and we were in the middle of something, simply putting down some visual reminder that this isn't finished forever, but we need to finish this for right now and come right back to it. We can press play on this. I was in a classroom last year and doing a puzzle with a group of students, and one had autism, and you know, that puzzle needed to be finished before we went to lunch. And so I grabbed a sheet of paper out of the teacher's printer and just quickly drew the circle with the two lines and explained to him, oh, let's put this puzzle on pause and we can press play when we get back. And he immediately got up, got in line, and we were able to go to lunch. So a pause card can be helpful too, to help with those transitions. Visual schedules and checklists. Again, any sort of visual support is going to be helpful here. So whether you are supporting students at home during NTI or non-traditional instruction, or whether you just have certain things that you need to get done during the day, I am a queen. If you saw either my desk right now or even sometimes my coffee table at home is just full of post-it notes, things that I need to remind myself to do. Having some sort of small list and keeping it manageable, keeping it short with just 2 or 3 things at a time. If you give someone a list of 10 to 20 things, that's not going to be helpful. So whether that's, you know, just breaking it up, the picture on the right, I've actually used something like that myself as I'm now working from home and trying to balance a full-time job, but also being at home and having things like laundry and dishes and pets to still take care of. So giving yourself maybe 2 required work or school tasks and 1 required home task, either for the entire day, or this just may be something that, say, Johnny needs to do his 1 math worksheet, read for 20 minutes and fill the dog bowls, and then he gets a 30-minute break. When that 30-minute break is over, then he'll have a new post-it with some new tasks to do, chunking that day up into different manageable sections of time and tasks. And just that visual reminder of what has to get done today, and even in what order that needs to be accomplished. Another school-age strategy, and again, as we are now trying to navigate this new world of being at home all the time and trying to keep our sanity and keep our home a safe place, making sure that we're practicing good sleep hygiene, making sure that we're balancing that caffeine and screen time with good sleeping habits. If you just even Google the word sleep hygiene, you will get an abundance of articles and great visuals to help understand what a bedtime routine should look like. And we all, I think, need more work on this. I'm willing to bet most of us here on this webinar sleep with our cell phones within arm's reach. That's not a great thing, you know, but again, I'm not that great at it either. We need to make sure we're turning off the television and the caffeine well before bed so that way we can be well rested and be ready to focus the next day. And building in that bedtime routine and learning, you know, we need to turn off the TV at this time each day. And then what are some things we can do that don't involve screens or caffeine as part of our bedtime routine? And then a few final school age strategies to help with either that working memory that may be a challenge for some of our school age learners. Having those visuals, having either written instructions, copies of their notes, helping them sequence their tasks. Also with difficulty focusing, you know, if you've been in any classroom ever or any school ever, you know that they can be very noisy places. But even at home, we need to make sure that we can reduce some of the noise and make sure that we have a quiet, distraction-free place. Especially now that everyone is at home under the same roof at times, and helping establish those routines, making sure that we do our schoolwork at this table or in this chair every day. This is our routine. It's free from distractions. We have all of our materials here, whether that's, you know, scissors, Chromebook chargers, all pencil, paper, those things that we need to prevent those distractions. Giving those clear single step directions, one thing at a time. And again, eliminating or reducing time constraints as much as possible to reduce some of that pressure and that unneeded stress. If it's okay with you all, I will go ahead and get through these adulthood strategies and into our resources, and we should have probably a good 15 minutes, I think, for questions towards the end. So unless something really pressing has come through, I'm going to keep on moving and get through the rest of our content together. So adulthood strategies, this was one that came up in our first executive functioning training. There were some great questions toward the end about supporting adults, either with autism or other disabilities, as they navigate the workplace or just adulthood in general. And I was very fortunate to get a lot of feedback from autistic adults and things that I may not have necessarily thought of as supports for them to help overcome their executive dysfunction. So this section I was really excited about. And again, knowing some of these are things that you may have younger children or younger people that you're supporting that would still benefit from these strategies. So the first few are going to be some great examples I've seen of visual supports for the workplace or even life skills at home if we're working on these. This is one from a local here in Louisville company called Wiggle Wow. Some of you may be familiar with them. They hire people with disabilities. And this young guy, this was on their Facebook just a month ago that I saw, and I had a screenshot of it because I knew this was an excellent, excellent visual support for the workplace. This young man had a really difficult time counting out the number of dog treats that he needed to put in each bag. So what they did is they realized, well, if we put those probably 20 or 30, it looks like, dog treats in a rectangle, it is this size. So he used his little rectangular piece of whatever that is to measure and count out his treats to help him independently do his job. I just love this one. So shout out to Wiggle Wow. My dog loves your treats too. These are some other ones that teaching adults, either if it's part of their job or just being an adult at home, teaching them how to vacuum. So on the left, you see a grid. So knowing that we just need to do a small section at a time, and there's post-its with arrows showing which direction the vacuum needs to go in. We push it forward, then we push it backwards. We push it forward and we push it backwards, and we do it in grids. The same type of principle for Swiffering or sweeping floors, having a checklist to follow, even with some color coding or some labels, whatever visual support you can provide. And a similar one for teaching how to clean a window and having a little flip book of those different steps. And again, with color coding, I love color coding, but making sure that it's clear and it allows our learners to conduct those tasks independently and successfully and correctly. Another strategy that came through from adults with, you know, navigating their executive dysfunction is that self-care piece, which is important for all of us, especially during these times, but even more so our loved ones and those we support with disabilities. You know, making sure that they're able to recognize those emotions in themselves, knowing what those different emotions feel like. What are the signs that they're getting overwhelmed or overworked? You know, we know what some of those triggers are for ourselves or when we start feeling like we're stressed, but making sure that our loved ones or those we support are able to recognize and identify those emotions in themselves. Also scheduling that time for self-care. You know, as a teacher, we always said, you know, when a child truly needs a break, that's when they're least likely to ask for one. So making sure that we have opportunities throughout the week that we have this time scheduled in, even if we don't feel like we need it, to make sure that that's still part of our routine and that we're practicing that self-care. Also having a menu of options, knowing on a Tuesday I may want to do this to unwind, but on Saturday I may want to do something else. Also that positive self-talk, being able to think through that anxiety that may come with stress or uncertainty that executive dysfunction can cause. Telling yourself things like, this will get better, this is only temporary. And working through things like breathing strategies or other scripting that you may be able to do to yourself to get through that moment. So in your slide, you have a blank one. What would go on your self-care choice board? You know, if I know that these past, 9 months working from home and my entire job is now virtual on a computer, I've had to really up my self-care game. So for me, either after a long day or in between really rough work tasks, these are some things that I would add to my self-care choice board. My favorite shows, Schitt's Creek in the First 48, A Brownie Sunday from Graders. Now, trying to exercise lately, that one doesn't get chosen as often on my choice board, but a nice bath or when the weather was warmer out in my hammock. Retail therapy is real, y'all. That add to cart, there's something about clicking that button that just immediately makes you feel a little bit better. Cuddling my two adorable dogs, even if they don't want to cuddle me. And reading, I've really developed my love of reading lately again and really realized that I don't just have to read textbooks and academic articles. There are things I can read just for fun. So making sure that either you or your loved ones have a nice array of things that they could do to unwind after a long day or take 5 to 10 to 30 minutes to just kind of calm down and unwind. There are also lots of great visuals out there on the internet. I follow on Instagram. There are a lot of different either anxiety-based or kind of mental health or therapy-based accounts that have excellent visuals like this one to, again, really help understand what are those physical signs that I may be overworked or I may be overwhelmed, and making sure that we're paying attention to those and really being proactive and not waiting till we've hit that wall. This one came up from just about every autistic adult that got back to me, and it was something that's so simple yet so powerful, is scheduling check-ins and making sure that you have someone in your life. It could be a parent, it could be someone outside of your family that is kind of your mentor, your accountability partner, making sure that you're able to connect with others and share things and be open and honest that, hey, today was a rough week. maybe we need to check in twice next week. And making sure that any strategy that we offer is person-centered. You know, as I mentioned earlier, we don't want to just add extra stress. We want to find strategies and tools that are going to work for our loved ones or those we support, and that will help them, that they can buy into, not just things that we think, oh, well, it worked for me, it'll automatically work for you. And then my final adulthood strategy, and this is the one where if I had the time, I would go through and show you my cell phone, because I use so many of these. Utilizing technology is going to be crucial for your adults. Using things like the calendars in your phone. I actually use one called WeekCal. Again, I'm an Apple iPhone user. That WeekCal is incredible. I love it. It's color-coded. Mine is, of course. You know, I have birthdays in yellow. I have work events and activities in red. I have personal events and activities in green. I have medical doctor's appointments in blue. And it pulls from all your different other calendars into one. Using things like the notes on your phone. I have an insane amount of notes on my phone that I can also pull up on my computer or on my iPad. Shopping lists. Any list is my favorite because I now have my grocery list organized from when I walk in this door on the left. All of the different categories of the grocery are laid out in the order that they are. So I can get in one door and out the other and get all of my groceries in the order that they're going to be in the store. It may sound extreme, but it helps me get through that challenge of going to the grocery. Using things like storing passwords, apps to have bill pay. That's the other thing on my calendar. I have a little purple icon for each of my bills and when those are due. Using pharmacy apps that now they will even automatically refill and mail those to you. One thing I've learned lately is, again, if you are an iPhone user, Siri, you can set it to where she is like my best friend now. I don't even have to press a button. There have been so many nights where I'm laying in bed and all I have to say is, hey, Siri. She turns on and I say, remind me at 9 o'clock in the morning to change the litter box because I forgot to do that and I'm already in bed and comfortable. And she will do that and she will remind me. So again, if you looked at the reminders in my phone, most of them are related to that silly litter box that I can never remember to clean each day. And getting things in writing, having things in some sort of organized fashion to be written down so that you can refer back to them and keep track of everything without having to remember. So in summary, these are some of the most general strategies that I think would help anyone, again, whether you have autism, another disability, whether you're neurotypical and you're just trying to navigate this dang pandemic, what are some things that can help you be more successful and overcome some challenges with executive functioning? These are some of the most common ones, those labels, those very predictable routines that stay the same day after day, scheduling those breaks, scheduling check-ins with other people. Oh, sorry. If you guys just heard, I had my Siri come on. And now she's telling me to clean my litter box tomorrow morning, so I need to turn her off. Using those tech tools, even though sometimes they can go haywire like they just did, and building those self-awareness skills and that emotional regulation. This last piece, I will just go very quickly because in your PDFs, you will be able to click on every single one of these icons and access the different resources and websites if you want to dive a little bit deeper. So we have two excellent books that I love. The one on the right is one that I used as a classroom teacher and shared with all of my co-teachers. It's a great, easy read about autism spectrum disorder and how to really support those students in the classroom. And the one on the left is, again, a very nice, easy to digest book about executive function skills. And if you click each one of those, it will take you to links for those. These are four of my favorite websites and blogs that really help with executive function and other strategies. Seth Perler is the guy when it comes to executive functioning. If you have not heard him or checked him out, please do that. He has regular webinars, tons of free resources. Additionally, those other websites have a lot of free tools and resources and strategies for you. So be sure to check those out. The Autism Helper, Sasha Long, she just came out recently with 6 remote learning tips for children with executive functioning. So that is about 20, 22 minute podcast that she has there, and you should be able to click that image right there and be taken to her podcast. These are two very brief, they're right around 7.5 minute quick videos through the Bright and Quirky group. They have a lot of great strategies too. But I also have this slide remembering that, you know, it's not just that your child or the person you're supporting is unmotivated or lazy. They are experiencing some sort of executive dysfunction and they need our help or some other visual or strategy to help overcome that. These are the links to those two questionnaires I mentioned earlier. You can be able to click these and really help prioritize maybe which area or areas of executive dysfunction do we need to address first. Here are two articles at the bottom that are really great practical strategies, and the one up top is a online module you can go through at your own pace through the Northern Kentucky Educational Cooperative on executive function in the classroom with students. These next two are tools that I just love and use very often and want every person to know about them. The Organization for Autism Research has free resources available electronically, but they will also send you those books listed at the bottom, up to 2 free per each address. So specifically that Transition to Adulthood Guide, the College Guide, the Employer's Guide, the Education Guide, those are great tools for families that are free. Free is my favorite 4-letter word. I love something that's free, but also something that's good and useful. The Center on Social and Emotional Foundations for Early Learning, it's a mouthful, but it is great. Their website has an insane amount of resources and training modules for families looking towards those early learning skills for our young children. I also have to shout out, you know, that piece about, you know, making connections and having some sort of mentor, learning from other people. Definitely, if you have, you know, a young adult or an adult in your life, making sure that they're connected with other autistic adults, either through ASAN, their website. I'm on at least once a week, I feel like, finding resources and information. We also have 2 affiliate groups of the national ASAN here in Kentucky, one based out of Lexington and one based out of Louisville. And there are great people in those groups. So reaching out to them either on Facebook, which are linked there, email, making sure that we are making those connections. Out of the University of Kentucky with HDI and as part of the Advisory Council on Autism, Bev Harp, one of my favorite people, has this ISAW project. So knowing that if we are supporting adults either with autism in the workplace, ISAW has, again, a ton of resources here for you. Definitely check out their website. There are some free training modules, and Bev will even train specific workplaces and agencies if they so desire. Just a shout out to our Kentucky Advisory Council. Tal Curry has done a great amount of work organizing the website into resources for those different age groups we talked about. So definitely checking out that website if you haven't. And that is it. I will be on for questions. And again, you guys have the PDF either here in our panel. Stella will get that emailed to you or someone else from Kentucky Spin, either Michaela or Kelly. And definitely reach out to me if there's anything that either I or someone at KATC can do for you. Definitely follow us on Facebook, Twitter, check out our YouTube and our website. We are here, again, as a support to anyone in Kentucky who wants and needs information on autism. So again, I will stick around if there are questions. I appreciate you all for spending this day with me this afternoon, and hopefully you guys are all able to enjoy the rest of your day and the rest of your week. So Stella, I will...
We do have questions, Sarah. So one of the questions that I see is, where can I find more info on developing a bedtime routine?
Oh, yes. So what I encourage you to do is get on Google. It has its pros and cons. Google sleep hygiene. There are some really great articles, even just some nice visuals to really help identify what are some things that really help us just as humans sleep better. And it's part of building that routine. Even if you need a small sort of visual schedule just for the hours, maybe 8 p.m. to 10 p.m., knowing that, okay, at 8 p.m., or around there, we turn off the video games and maybe we can do a puzzle together, or maybe we can do something that doesn't involve technology. We brush our teeth and then we put on our pajamas, or whatever order that we do things. Definitely looking at some sort of visual schedule or routine to follow and being very consistent with that. So that's the other thing that I struggle with, but hopefully you'll be better, is knowing that even if it's a Saturday night, we still need to keep that same bedtime routine as close as possible. I think the research says within an hour. So trying to stay within an hour of that weekday routine as well.
Yeah, I think that's so important, that it's the consistency that really, really helps.
And even, you know, as we're going to be on Christmas break or holiday break, you know, knowing that we still shouldn't be sleeping in all day, even though if you know me, you know, I love sleeping in.
I think we all would enjoy that every now and then, yes.
Especially when it's cold outside.
Yes, exactly. Well, another question we have is, who can I talk to about implementing supports in the workplace for my adult child?
Yes, so I would definitely encourage you to check out ISAW, that project with Bev Harp. So she has training modules that employers can access. She even does trainings for companies. But also, I'm assuming it's your child that you're supporting, you know, if they were in a public school in Kentucky and they got connected with OVR, the Office of Vocational Rehabilitation, they should have a coach available to them to help collaborate services between, you know, the workplace and maybe what they got at school, and helping navigate that. So I would definitely get connected with OVR, the Office for Vocational Rehabilitation. And if you need my help with that, shoot me an email, or I'm sure some people at Kentucky Spin can help with that. But also Bev Harp at ISAW, that is one of her primary roles, is getting workplaces comfortable and familiar with accommodating autistic workers.
That's great. That's great information. Another question is, do you find that it's difficult for adults or young adults with executive dysfunction to get people to attempt to understand it? And how would you recommend they approach a situation where this is an issue?
I think it's definitely difficult to understand themselves, but then also it's a totally different skill to explain that to someone else. And I think it's if you could start with having maybe one close person that you can really come up with some ideas and strategies of, this is maybe the one or two things that I need from other people in my life, and being able to communicate just one or two helpful things instead of trying to unload, you know, these are all of my needs and these are all of the things that I need from you, trying to again prioritize with that. And even, you know, sharing some resources, either some great things that you can find either on that ASAN, the Autistic Self-Advocacy Network, some articles or some videos. I know on YouTube, I love Amethyst Shaber. She has a whole Ask an Autistic series on YouTube, and finding ways that someone else is already kind of explaining that, so that takes a little bit of the pressure off of you as well.
That's good. That's good. Just a couple more.
Yeah.
How can I work with my young adult to find a balance in self-care? And then they gave some examples. They said, you know, her son completes a difficult task and then wants to overindulge. So he seems to think that taking care of himself includes like playing video games all day or overeating or overspending. So what are ways that they can create that balance?
Yeah, and it's definitely gonna work. Like, you need to have the balance between the effort that you put in into that task versus the reward. You know, if I've had a really awful day, I may go to Grater's and get that full-blown sundae with nuts and whipped cream. But if I just had a kind of challenging day, I may take a scoop of Ben and Jerry's. So finding, as part of that choice board or some sort of choices, tailoring those to the specific tasks. Or if you've got a specific schedule that you're working through during the day, maybe saving some of those breaks or self-care things, maybe just for the weekends or just for the end of the day. And it's appropriate to put time limits on those, because again, that and setting those quantifiable limits, like you can spend $5 at the Dollar Tree, or you can you can spend 20 minutes on the Xbox. Having that quantity is going to be helpful too for that time management and finance management, keeping it very closed-ended. Because if we just say, oh, well, you can go play on your Xbox now, that's not as specific. So putting some sort of number to that and working through it and helping them understand, you know, what are some appropriate reinforcement for a specific activity. We don't always earn the big ones, if that makes sense.
Yes, I really like that. I think that's a great, you know, option for them to do. And then just one more. How do you come up with your grocery system? Does an app tell you what aisle all the items are in, or did that take time and effort on your part?
So, okay, my grocery list is one of my favorite things. I hope this person is still on the webinar, and if not, hopefully they will email me. So the app that I found, and it's been a long time coming, but this AnyList app, it's on my iPhone. So what you do is I have a list just for groceries, and there's different categories, and you can move categories around in the app. So like I am very routine based. I enter the left door of Kroger, and I try to stick with just the Kroger near my house, because we all know every single grocery store is laid out differently, which that drives me crazy. But I know when I come in that left door, that's where produce is. And then I'm going to hit the bakery because it's right there. And then I'm going to hit the all the different categories from kind of left to right in the grocery store. And I'm able to move those big categories around in my app. If I realize, oh, I really come to the bread before I come to the snacks, I can move those around. And each food item that you add to your grocery list is automatically put into one of those categories. Sometimes you have to fine tune it. If it's a really specific thing that you've put in there, you need to go in and say, oh, this belongs in the dairy section, but it will remember that every single time. It's one of my favorite things, and it was a free app. It is just the best thing ever.
What was the name of it again?
It's just called AnyList, and the icon was on, I had it on the slides.
Yeah. I remember seeing it on the slide.
Yeah, and it's just a little blue icon. It was a free app here on my iPhone, and it has been the best.
I love that. Okay, great. Well, I think that's all. One person just commented and said, what wonderful information, and they were so appreciative of that, and I agree. I think this has been so informative. And, right. You know, one of the things that works great with my son is the list. Uh-huh. And schedules. Yep. And he knows he's very, very routine oriented. And even though he doesn't have much of a concept of time, he does know, you know, 12 o'clock is this, and 4 o'clock he does this, and 6 right. o'clock he does that. And that has really helped him, you know, begin to remember things and having those checkpoints and reminders for him instead of me vocalizing it. Like you said, a reminder pops up, you know, on his phone to remind him instead of me to do, you know, so an adult doing it all the time. So I love using technology, and I love all of the suggestions that you made. They were just great.
I joke, my mom would always say, remind me to do this, or, you know, even if she's like, remind me to talk to you about that. I'm like, have Siri remind you, because Siri is much more reliable than I am. So Siri and all those tech tools that we have are excellent. We have to embrace those.
I love that. And I had not even thought about telling Siri. So that is definitely the one takeaway I'm going to use with him on some things too. Instead of just going in and setting the reminders, we're going to get Siri to do them. So
I love that now you don't even have to have your phone near, like in your hand. Like I said, there are so many nights where I'm laying in bed and I have to say, hey Siri, she turns on, and I have to remind her to remind me to do something either the next morning or the next day, because I'm already in bed and I don't want to get up and write it down. So you can set it to where, oh, and again, she's coming on because she heard me say, hey, Siri. But you don't even have to press the button anymore. So it makes your life much easier.
I love that. So thank you for that little takeaway for me, for sure. But just to wrap up again, as I said at the beginning, every Tuesday and every Thursday, we are providing webinars on a variety of topics. And we're very excited about, we've already scheduled pretty much for January and February, and we'll be releasing those dates coming out very soon. So we're excited about that. Actually, this Thursday, we are having a webinar on stable accounts, and Carolyn Wheeler will be presenting for that session. So there's still plenty of room. You can go on our website and register for that. And then we also have on our website all of the up-to-date information and resources with COVID-19 and how that relates to education. And then if you want to sign up for our e-news, please feel free to do that. You can go to our website and do that. And we send that out usually every other week. So lots of great resources and information is included in that. But thank you so much for everyone that was on today. And Sarah, thank you for all the wonderful information. And you'll be prompted at the end to take a quick evaluation. If you would do that, it certainly helps us plan for the future and let us know if there are things that we need to do better or that we need to, some topics maybe that you all would like to hear. So thanks again. And thanks again, Sarah. And we hope everyone has a wonderful day.
Yes, thank you all.